People don't understand the role of your neurotransmitter, your brain chemicals, on performance, either on peaking for a test or just having a good workout. And here's the thing, okay. You have two key neurotransmitters that will come into play when it comes to motivation, focus, drive, readiness, anything that will give you a good performance. You have dopamine, then you have serotonin. Dopamine will amp you up, will make you competitive, will make you driven, will increase contraction strength, power, name it. Serotonin, it keeps you chill, bro. Okay, it relaxes you. It calms you down, which is good because it helps you deal with stress. But it's not exactly something you want elevated when you have to have a high power, high speed performance. You want dopamine to be high because that is what puts you into the zone. Now, that's where the proper use of recovery days is important, because depending on who you are, taking more recovery days before a competition or a peaking will actually lead to worse performance. I'm going to give you an example. An athlete I was training, he was preparing for his physical testing, which was 30 meter power clean, bench press, vertical jump, and medicine ball throw. And then 2 weeks before the event, we did a pre-planning, a pre-peaking approach, just to test out a peaking procedure. My goal was to have him rest 2 days before the test, and then do an activation session, neural charge session, like I mentioned earlier, the day before, to amp up his dopamine. But because of, well, his girlfriend, it's always about the girlfriend, right? I mean, in my case, it's always about the wife. So he decided, like, priority in all the wrong places. He decided to spend the weekend with her, like, go to a restaurant, do activities together, like, all that. This thing that would just kill an athlete, right? So instead of resting only on Saturday and then doing an activation on Sunday and then testing on Monday, he actually rested both Saturday and Sunday. So then he went in for his like first workout afterwards on Monday, and we're talking about an athlete who for the whole year never ran slower than 3.8 on a 30 meter sprint, and he just turned in a 3.93. He called me up in panic, "Christian, I ran 3.93. My test is in 5 days. I'm gonna screw up. What happened?" And I thought, talking, well, how did you feel? "Well, I didn't train the whole weekend. I thought I would be like really rested. I was expecting big performance, but when I woke up, my muscles fell flat. It's like I had no drive, no motivation, and my muscles felt small." So my first question was, okay, flat muscles, maybe he didn't eat enough, so he had flat muscle from low muscle glycogen. So I asked him, "Well, did you eat enough during the weekend?" He said, "Dude, my girlfriend and I ate so much crap, dude." Okay, so was it like carbs or fat? No, tons of carbs. Okay, so if he ate tons of carbs, he can't have low muscle glycogen. What could explain flat muscle, feeling small muscle? The only thing that could explain those flat muscle or feeling small is low CNS activity. If the nervous system, okay, muscle tone, how hard the muscles are even at rest. Muscle tone, it's a state of partial muscle activation derived from an activity of the nervous system. If the nervous system is amped up, the muscles are harder. If the nervous system is chill, bro, the muscles are softer. So the fact that he was not glycogen depleted, the fact that his muscle felt small and weak was because his nervous system was calm, was chill. So low dopamine, high serotonin. Now the fact that he said that he had a lot of carbs gave us a clue. Here's the thing. When you eat protein, you have tyrosine, which is an amino acid, you have tryptophan, which is another amino acid. Tyrosine will be converted to dopamine. Yay. Tryptophan is converted to serotonin. Boo. For performance. For recovery, it's good. Now, here's the thing. What you are eating has a very strong impact on which one you will favor, because both tryptophan and tyrosine are fighting for absorption and transport. one will always be favored over the other. If you're having more carbs in your stomach when you have those amino acids, you will favor tryptophan. If you have low carbs, more fat, you will favor tyrosine. That's why Charles Poliquin used to recommend the meat and nuts breakfast, because it spiked up dopamine, giving you that more competitive, more positive mindset. So the fact that he had tons of carbs increased his serotonin. The fact that he was physically inactive the whole weekend kept his dopamine low. So he got into a Monday workout, low dopamine, high serotonin, very high to get amped up, very high to get amped up, okay? Not surprisingly, the next day, he actually hit a PR on the loaded 10-meter sprint. And then, with the proper peaking procedure, which did not include the day off before the test, and which focused more on lower carbs and higher fat the last day, he hit a significant PR on 30 meter, hitting 3.71, which was a big, big PR. He also went on to have the best test results of all the other athletes there. So it was good peaking procedure. What I'm getting at here is that if you want to properly peak, it's not just about recovering. In this case, we would have assumed, dude, you had the whole weekend to recover. You ate a lot, so you should be well recovered. Yeah, his muscles were recovered, but his nervous system was not in a good working state because he didn't have the right neurotransmitter balance to perform optimally. So that's something you need to consider when designing a peaking program. Not only training, but also the impact of nutrition.